The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
At that time, Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every infirmity. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Last month, the beginning of September, during the novenas towards Mother Mary, her birthday, our parish decided to have online rosaries, online novenas. And it went very smoothly. And every day after the rosary, we would take the practice of the readers for the next day. So the next day's readers would practice. And there was this one day where we were taking practice after the novenas to check the mic, if it's too loud, too soft, the mic is too far. And there was this one man who was very involved in the parish, very nice man. But we just couldn't hear what he was saying. His network was very bad. And he was the one who was supposed to lead the rosary. And if we could not hear him, then we could not respond. So at the end, I told him that, it's not your fault. The network is bad. We can't do anything about it. But we have to replace you. Bring somebody else in your place. And we replaced him. That same night, he called me furious. And he told me that I had been practicing for 1 week. And in a matter of a second, you replaced me. And then he told me that that day when the practice was going on, I was at a friend's house who wasn't well. I went to take medicines for him. And the network was bad in his house. But in my house, it would have been fine. And I realized at that moment that he was very hurt. But the whole situation was based on misunderstanding. See, I didn't know that he was in somebody else's house. And he assumed that I knew he was somewhere else. Luckily, we clarified this misunderstanding and things were smooth again. But it got me thinking about how we lose so many people in our lives because of some small misunderstandings. Husbands and wives, parents and children, siblings, best friends, we have lost people just because of some misunderstanding. And not only people, the church herself has been misunderstood in so many ways, even till recently in this week, where the cardinal had to release a press note for something that was said by Pope Francis, which was misinterpreted. What Pope Francis said and what he meant and what people understood were totally different, and a press note had to be released. And in the end of the press note, the last line says so clearly that our Pope Francis has been misunderstood and misinterpreted. My dear brothers and sisters, all of you all must be wondering, why am I talking about misunderstanding when the theme for today is vocations and the saint for today is Saint Jean-Marie Vianney? You know, we have heard a lot about this great saint and we know a lot about vocations. But today I thought I would clarify certain misunderstandings that we have about the saint and also about vocations. You know, we grow up thinking that Saint Jean-Marie Vianney was a man of below average intellect. We were always told that he didn't do well in his seminary studies. In fact, many people thought that I had hope because he passed his exams. But we failed to understand that he was born during the French Revolution and his formal education was disrupted because of the revolution. And he had a problem with the language, with Latin. And in the seminary, where the studies and the exams were conducted in Latin, he had difficulty with that. You see, if tomorrow I ask you to give exams in a language that you are not comfortable in, I am sure you won't do well in those papers. Not knowing a language does not mean that you are not smart. Not having enough education does not mean that you are below average. When he died, they found numerous books in his room. He was a well-read man, a man who brought people closer to God. You cannot be dull and know people so well. You cannot be of below par and yet help people experience God's presence in their lives. He has been misunderstood in this context. And when we talk about vocations, the patron saint of priests, of diocesan priests, so I'll focus mainly on priesthood. You know, most people think that discerning a vocation is very simple and very clear. What most people don't understand and don't know, the problems that one goes through while discerning to become a priest. You know, you have young boys who are probably going to take the biggest decision in their lives. They are going to leave their families, their friends, their jobs if they are working. It's a difficult decision. You go through a lot of stress, a lot of doubt, a lot of fear. And I remember when I was joining the seminary, I had people giving me advice, telling me that even if you have 1% doubt, then you are not called to be a priest. And I remember when I met my fellow classmates, all of them stated about how they went through this turmoil and doubt. So my suggestion to all those who are discerning to become priests, if you have some doubt, if you are scared, if you have some inhibitions, welcome to the party. We have gone through this. I know what you go through. It's part of your discernment process. Don't give up, but pursue this vocation of yours. You know, after you join, another very sad misunderstanding that people have towards vocations is that once you join, you should not leave. Once you become a seminarian, you should not come home. But what happens to those who in the course of their seminary studies realize that they are not called to become priests? Is it not better for them to leave and be happy lay people rather than being an unhappy priest? You know, the day I joined the seminary, my mom told me something. And I remember that day like it was yesterday. It was exactly after the prayer service in the seminary to initiate the newcomers. And she took me on the side and she told me that, you know, if at any point in your life you think that you are not called to be a priest, pack your bags and come home. Don't bother what people think about you. And that one line gave me so much strength to go fearlessly into my seminary studies. You know, we put pressure on those who then feel who are not called to become priests. But I look up to those who take a stand and who face society. You know, to give a parallel example, it's like telling a girl who is married and who is being beaten up in a married house, once you are married, you cannot come home. That girl's being beaten up somewhere and she can't come back to her own house. It's probably the worst advice to give someone. And similarly, when you tell a seminarian that once you join, you can't come home, it's a misunderstanding. We have 8 years and more to discern our vocations. You know, one more very hilarious misconception that we have about vocations, which happened to me just probably a week or two ago. I got a phone call from one of the youth from another parish. And he sounded very upset, but he told me that, you know, Father, I have decided to become a priest. And I was very happy. I was on the verge of giving him the seminary phone number. But I asked him, what is it that made you, what is it that gave you this thought of becoming a priest? And he said, you know, during this lockdown, my salary has been cut. And I know I'm going to lose my job very soon. And I don't think we are going to get jobs very soon. I think it's better to become a priest. And he looked at, and he spoke to me with dead seriousness. And I looked at him and I spoke to him and I told him that that's not how it works. You don't join the seminary because you had nothing else to do in life. But he asked me, isn't that why you became a priest? I didn't know if I should laugh or cry at that time. But you know, many people think that we seminarians or priests had no other options in life. And this was our last option. But many of us came from high-flying jobs, from very good, we had good salaries. Some of us were professional chefs. You know, Warner can give MasterChef Australia a run for their money. He's feeding me afterwards. In my time, we had professional chefs, professional musicians. We had lecturers in colleges. We had a nuclear physicist. We had MBA students, MBA graduates, who left everything and became priests. So don't ever feel that our vocations are based on people who maybe had nothing to do in life, but there are people who have given up a lot to be where we are today. My dear friends, I can go on in so many of these misunderstandings that we have about vocations, that we have about priesthood. You know, today's gospel says so beautifully, the harvest is rich, but the laborers are few. And when we think about laborers, you know, we think about St. John Marie Vianney, we think about these great saints, and the first thing that comes to mind when we think about saints is sacrifice. That these great people have sacrificed everything that they have for the Lord. And then they connect that with priesthood. And I know people have told me that, you know, Father, you have sacrificed so much from your life to become a priest. And I look at them and I say, that's not true. Sacrifice is a very, very small part of our lives. Sacrifice is part of anybody's life. But a vocation is not based on sacrifice. A vocation is based on happiness. Nobody joins a seminary to be unhappy. Nobody joins a seminary to be sad. Our happiness lies in priesthood. Our happiness lies in where we are. And if you see, a happy priest is a good priest. And therefore, my dear friends, if you feel that you are happy in discerning towards priesthood, or you are happy where you are, your vocation lies in that. Leave aside the sacrifice, leave aside the pain, leave aside everything else. Happiness and love for God is what we are called to do. You know, when we use the word vocation, the first thing that comes to mind is priesthood or religious life. But what is so important for us to understand that vocation is so much more than just priesthood. Vocations is a calling. We are all called for something. God has a vocation for all of us. I will never believe that we are here in this world without a purpose. God has some purpose for all of us. Our job is to find that purpose. And finding that purpose is not easy. It may take years and decades, probably a lifetime. And maybe even one lifetime is not enough for us to find what our true purpose is in this world. That does not mean that we live bad lives. Living good and bad lives is different from finding who we are and what we are called for in this life. My dear friends, we are all born for something. We are all born with some purpose in mind. He has that purpose. We are all born for greatness. Let us ask ourselves, what is our vocation? Not all vocations are towards priesthood. But everybody has a vocation. Not all callings are towards the calling of seminary life, but everybody has a calling. Our job is to answer that call. In this Mass, as we reflect on the life of John Marie Vianney, we also look at the type of priest that he was and the type of priest that we look for today. You know, he is known for his simplicity. He was known for the simple life that he lived. And in that simplicity, he brought so many people close to God. What is our expectation of our priest today? Today's world, a good priest is probably somebody who is a dynamic priest, who organizes a lot of things. But ultimately, I believe a good priest, a good vocation, is somebody who helps people experience God. My dear friends, in this Mass, as we pray for vocations, as we pray for our personal calling, we pray for all the priests in this diocese and all over that we follow our purpose and we stay faithful to our call, the call that is His. Amen.